This is an example from the book, which I really like. It talks about Milton Ericsson. Dr. Milton Ericsson. So he was a very famous psychiatrist and hypnotist. And his story is very, very interesting. So when he was young, he lived in Wisconsin, in a state in the US, in a small town. And he lived in a house with his seven sisters, one brother, his parents, and a caretaker or a nurse. When he was young, one day he woke up and he couldn't move his body. So his mother called a doctor, and the doctor came to the house and checked his situation and told his mother, "Your son has polio." At that time, polio was a very common disease. Polio, it affects usually the legs or even the body. It stops people from moving. There are many people who used to have polio. So the doctor arrives and tells his mother, "Your son has polio. It's very, very serious, and he is probably going to die tomorrow." The doctor said this to his mother outside the room. They didn't want Milton to hear this, but Milton heard it. And his mother came into the room later just to check on him, and she seemed really worried. Milton saw her face, even though he already knew what the doctor said. He saw her face and could tell that she was really, really afraid, and she was also really sad. She didn't have to use verbal communication. She tried to hide her feelings, but he could tell just by her facial expressions and her body language how she was feeling. He asked her to move the table because the table had a mirror. It was a dressing table, right? 化妆台. And he wanted her to move the mirror into such a position that he could see through the window, because remember, he couldn't move anything except for his eyes. So he could look at the mirror and see the reflection of the sun set. And that's all he wanted. And he kept saying, "Please move it a little left, move it a little right." And he was doing this for two reasons. One of them was, yes, he wanted to see the sunset. And the second was that he wanted his mother to not focus so much on him. He wanted to distract his mother's focus by asking her to move the table and the mirror. Irene.
就是那个朋友有一个例子，然后就那个叫Milton Ericsson这个人，他是一个美国的精神病学的专家，然后在他就是小的时候，他就是和他七个兄弟姐妹住在那个美国的一个小镇上面，然后呢就有一次他起床就发现他就不能挪动他的那个身体，然后他妈妈就。 就请来了医生给他做检查嘛，然后检查出来就医生就告诉他妈妈，你儿子明天就要，然后，这就是一个悲伤的故事，然后，但是呢，就是他妈妈没有告诉他，但是他就偷这个 Milton 他就偷听到了这个医生讲的这个话，然后呢，他就知道了以后，他心里面也非常害怕，但是他。 就是尝试在母亲面前，就是尽量不去展露出自己的那个悲伤，然后就后面就讲到，就说，就是他的那个，他有个什么镜，化妆镜，然后不是镜子，然后那个镜子化妆镜。 镜子，然后那个他就想要去挪动他的那个镜子，然后其中一部分原因就是因为他想要让更多的那个阳光照进来。
Okay, I'll continue. So, the doctor was wrong. The next day, so he said that Milton was going to die the next day. But actually what happened was, the next day, Milton fell into a coma, 植物人, and he stayed in the coma for about 3 or 4 days. After those 3 or 4 days, he woke up. And he was still paralyzed. He still could not move his body, but he could move his eyes. And his condition was stable. Now, I said that he had 7 sisters, a brother, a nurse, and parents. And all of these people loved him and looked after him, even though he could do nothing for himself except move his eyes. His mind was very active. He couldn't speak for a few months, and all he would do is observe. He would watch, especially his sisters, and the way that his sisters communicated with each other. He noticed that there were situations where his sister would say yes, but actually she would shake her head, or that there would be tenseness in her face, or her muscles would be tense. And what this meant was that she was saying yes, but her body language was communicating that actually she means no, and she's just trying to be polite. By watching his sisters for a few days and the way that his sisters communicated with each other, he realized that there were so many different ways that their facial expressions were communicating something that the other sisters could not pick up, could not understand. He found that there were 16 different ways of saying no, but not by using the word. Another example was where one of his sisters was asking someone, was asking another sister, "Would you like my apple?" And the way that she asked it, he could tell she was just being polite. She did not actually want to offer the apple, but her sister didn't understand that and said, "Yes, thank you, I want it." And when she gave it, she was secretly a little unhappy. She felt, "Actually, I was just being polite. I didn't really want to give you the apple. I wanted to keep the apple for myself." Her body language was communicating that, but her words were different. Irene.
然后他大脑还是很活跃的，还是可以思考，然后应该是也可以继续跟他的兄弟姐妹讲话，就是不能讲，哦，那就不能讲，然后就是他就是在观察，他就在观察。
Continue. So after a few months, he slowly was able to start moving. The doctor was wrong. He found that he could slowly move the muscles in his leg, and his nurse started to massage the leg muscles, and slowly with practice he learned how to stand up, he learned how to walk, and he could walk longer and longer distances. He regained the ability to move his body. He did this by controlling his mind. He found that his mind and his body were completely connected, and by really focusing on his muscles, he was slowly able to walk again. This made him become very interested in how the mind and the body are connected. And so when he was older, he went to university and he got a degree in psychiatry. And he started to practice. He became a practicing psychiatrist and he started to see his own patients. But remember, because of that experience, because of the months that he spent just observing every little thing, all of these non-verbal cues that his sisters and the people around him used to communicate, but that other people could not really pick up, other people could not really see or understand, he really learned something about how people communicate non-verbally, as if there is a second language. This gave him a very, very different perspective. It gave him a very different way of practicing. So most psychiatrists focus very, very much on the words. They sit down with their patients and they ask questions and they listen to their patients. Their job is to focus on the words, to continue the conversation so that they can understand more based on what their clients or their patients say. But Milton Erickson was a very different kind of psychiatrist. He understood that body language was communicating so much and he had to pay more attention to that to really understand what was the problem that the client or the patient was having. Okay. Irene, can you translate what you got from that? Some examples of the way that he used body language. He became a master of reading people's body language. An example is, so one day, because he cared a lot about body language, he set up his office in such a way that his desk was at the back of the room. So when somebody entered the room, they had to walk all the way to his desk to sit down. And by doing that, he could observe how they walked. He could observe their body language while they were entering. And then he would watch as they sat down and how they settled. So one example is where a very beautiful woman entered his office, walked toward him, and he watched her, and then she sat down and said to him, "You know, I have already met 2 or 3 other psychiatrists, and I don't think that they were right. I'm still looking for the psychiatrist that's suitable for me. And I don't know if you are the right one." So Dr. Milton Erickson asked her a few questions, and while this beautiful woman was answering his questions, he noticed that she had a piece of lint on her dress, and he noticed that she just picked off the lint and threw it on the floor. He asked her 1 or 2 more questions, and then he said, "You know, I think I am the perfect psychiatrist for you." And she was quite surprised when he said this. She thought, "Why would you say that?" And she said, "Really? Please explain. Why do you think you are the best psychiatrist for me?" And he said, "Well, I have to just ask you 1 more question to show you." She said, "Okay." And he asked her, "How long have you been wearing women's clothes?" Because she was not a woman. He said, how did you know? How did you know that I'm wearing women's clothes, that I'm not a woman? And he said, it's because of the way that you picked off the lint. Most men would just pick it off very casually. But most women would naturally go around their breast area to pick it off. And he had seen that so many times with his sisters and probably with other women to immediately realize that that was not a woman, that was a man. Okay, one more example about Milton Erickson. So another patient, another woman came to his office to see him. But she arrived early. She arrived before he arrived. And so he wasn't able to see how she walked into the office. So he walked into the office and he sat down and she began to explain why she wanted to speak to him. But he said, hey, wait, please, I need you to leave the office and then I want you to walk back in and sit down. And she seemed a little surprised or a little like annoyed because of this, but she said, okay, whatever. And then she went out of his office and he watched the way that she walked out. And then she walked back in, she sat down and he watched how she walked and how she sat down. And then he said, okay, so can you now please explain what's the problem? Why are you here to see me? The woman said, my husband wants to take me abroad. We are going to travel to another country and I'm very afraid of flying in airplanes. Now, Milton Erickson was looking at her and he said, you know, when you have a psychiatry session, you have to tell me all of the truth. We do not hide things from each other. So the woman said, yeah, I understand that. And then he said, well, I need to ask you a very uncomfortable question. And the woman said, okay. So he asked her, how long have you been cheating on your husband? And the woman was shocked. She said, how did you know? And he said, I don't know if he told her, but the way that he knew was because the way the woman sat down. So the woman, when she sat down, she crossed her legs, right? So let's say these are her legs. She crossed her legs, but she did an extra cross around the ankle. So she kept her legs very, very tight as she crossed them and then around the ankle on the other side. And he noticed that women who sit like that are often having some kind of extra marital relationship. And he was right. So he said to the woman, can you bring your lover? I want to speak to your lover. And after one or two meetings, the woman brought her lover to meet Dr. Milton Erickson. And they started talking, and then he said to this man, I want to meet your wife. Can you please bring your wife to talk to me in this session? And he said, okay. And so his wife came to meet Milton Erickson. And again, Milton Erickson watched the way that she walked in and sat down. And he also asked her the same question. How long have you been sleeping with another man? And she was also very surprised. And he said, and she wanted to know how. She said, did my husband tell you? And he said, no, your body language told me. The way you sit, you're crossing your legs exactly the same way. You are crossing and then you are wrapping your leg around the ankle. That's how I knew. And he was right. Now, I don't know if this is true for everybody, but he was right in these two situations. It might have been other things that he saw, that he noticed in their body language that told him they have other lovers.